Welcome to the Pulse of St. Louis. I'm Shirley Washington. Tonight, we take a closer look at hospice and palliative care in the Gateway City area. According to the National Hospice and Palliative Care Organization, 1.4 million Medicare beneficiaries were enrolled in hospice care for one day or more in 2016. Joining me now are representatives from Seasons Hospice and Palliative Care, Deborah Knox, Burch. She's a chaplain. Jennifer Martin, she is a hospice and palliative care nurse. Brandy Earls, she's a nursing home administrator. And Carlos Turner, he is a hospice care consultant. And I said Deborah, and you just told me it's Deborah.
That's fine.
I apologize. Look at me. I apologize.
No problem.
Deborah. All right. So let's start the conversation by talking about hospice and palliative care and defining what each term actually means. Jennifer, what is hospice and then what is palliative care?
So hospice is for patients who have been diagnosed with a terminal illness and their physician has told them that they have less than 6 months to live. And they also,
it's okay. Hey, I got Deborah's name wrong.
Yeah,
it's
right.
Deborah, and I said Deborah. So.
And so that's the thing with hospice care. It's less than 6 months to live. Mm-hmm. And then that your physician has agreed that yes, you have less than 6 months to live. With mm-hmm. palliative care is someone who's been diagnosed with just a serious illness, even if they've just knew in their diagnosis, that you can actually have palliative care. And it's a wonderful program for someone to be in with a new diagnosis of congestive heart failure or COPD, because they do have symptoms that need to be palliated and be taken care of, but maybe sometimes their regular physicians aren't able to do that. Not only do that, but they also are able to coordinate care because, these patients with these illnesses have multiple physicians, and it's very hard for them to navigate all of that. So palliative care can help coordinate that and kind of, bring that message together, what they're all trying to say, and, make it easier for them to understand. There's also social workers with palliative care that are able to help with resources, those kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And then with hospice care, you actually get a full team. So I don't know if Deb, if you want to talk about, we have a supportive care team with the hospice benefit.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So who all makes up the team?
So the supportive care team is made up of the chaplain, the social worker, music therapist, and then the volunteer coordinator as well.
And then talk about the responsibilities of each member.
So if you have the social worker now, let's say a person is going to receive the hospice benefit, they have the right to pick and choose the disciplines that they desire. And so a patient might say, well, I don't want the music therapist. I just want the chaplain. And then they can change their minds throughout the course. And then, so if they were to choose the chaplain, the chaplain typically walks alongside the patient as well as their family members and provide holistic care. And that could look like anything from prayer, scripture reading, talking about the Cardinals game, or reminiscing. What we really like to do is facilitate verbalization of experience, allowing the patients and families to reminisce, and we provide storytelling and allow them to share their stories. And sometimes, that brings forth healing because we try to provide holistic care for the mind, body, and the spirit. And oftentimes you'll have families that may have doubts and fears and things of that nature, and that's where the reframing comes into play. And so oftentimes we see a lot of healing coming forth from that. And then we have the music therapist. And so we utilize music therapy as a non-pharmacological intervention during end of life. And it helps with the different symptoms that they may be experiencing, such as shortness of breath, anxiety, oftentimes pain. And so oftentimes when people think about music, they think about just entertainment. But it's very, very therapeutic. Our music therapists are very, very diligent in providing classical music, country, jazz, blues, rock.
Awesome.
Hymns, you name it, and they do this live. So they have live music, and there's a way of, say for instance, if the patient is experiencing anxiety and they're really, really rattled up, so they have a way of playing music at a very, very high pace. Hmm. And then eventually bringing the tones down and slowing down, you know, and then it helps to bring them down. They calm down from that.
It is kind of amazing to see mm-hmm. that happen. Yeah. You know, if you, whenever you go out with a music therapist and you see this in action, it's an amazing thing to see that they yeah. are at, you know, people think about medications and those kinds of things. There's so much other that we can do mm-hmm. to help with those symptoms.
Yeah, right. Even pets.
Exactly, pet therapy. Yeah, because yeah. sometimes yeah. people think that it's just pain, like I'm having a soreness in my mm-hmm. arm, when in all actuality, it's the pain of the heart, you know, aww. Just the issues of yeah. life and things of that nature. So, and then the social workers, they walk alongside with the patients and family and help with things from perhaps providing a resource to gain meals, mm-hmm. because sometimes, you know, they don't have meals anymore. Right. Perhaps the breadwinner is the patient that's now sick, things of that nature. Even in helping with placement, if they don't know where they're going to live or yeah. they don't have anyone to help take care of them, they help coordinate extra care providers to come into the home if a patient wants to stay at home and things of that nature. Because we have found that even with receiving the hospice benefit, although you have to have a 6-month prognosis, meaning if the disease were to take its natural course, end of life could happen within that 6-month time frame. When you receive the hospice benefit, patients oftentimes tend to do better because they have so much support.
Right. Yeah. Brandy, give me a sense of what the care looks like from a doctor and nurse perspective for people who are in hospice as well as those who are receiving palliative care.
So the great thing about hospice is it's available to anyone who has a Medicare benefit, a Medicare beneficiary, Medicaid, or a private insurance plan. Mm-hmm. Anyone over 65 can access the hospice benefit from Medicare. And what Deborah and Jennifer were sharing earlier about what we consider and call our circle of care is all of those pieces tied into the hospice benefit that are all accessible. Mm-hmm. So the physician is just one piece of that. And we provide an attending physician who's one of our medical directors that will help provide guidance and oversight. And then we still allow the patient's physician or any specialist, whoever they choose, to continue to be involved as an mm-hmm. attending. Yeah. And so it's a really nice collaboration. Our RN case managers, we assign to a patient and a family, and they are available 24/7, 365 days. That's the really beautiful thing about hospice is you call us first, we're there. We're going to be able to help mm-hmm. you, because at the end of the day, the hospice benefit is going for a not a curative approach, but a comfort approach. Mm-hmm. And then the visit frequencies are established based on the need. So mm-hmm. you can have a nurse in your home 5 days a week if needed. We typically start 1 to 3 days a week, and then we add in our care aides who come in and they help with the bathing, grooming, dressing, those things. A lot of things that individuals aren't able to do and their mm-hmm. support at home yeah. isn't able to do either. And again, another great benefit with our supportive services is giving that respite to the patient's loved ones. Mm-hmm. So hospice is not a place that you go. We meet you where you are and mm-hmm. in the home or whatever home
nursing
is to you,
nursing
homes. Mm-hmm. There's no stipulations on that. And with palliative care, those services aren't all available because palliative care is a little bit it's an intervention that happens before such a 6-month prognosis is so final. But even somebody that has multiple comorbidities and they make the decision to no longer live that day-to-day life of such a curative, aggressive, intensive treatment approach, multiple hospitalizations, they really want to change their quality of life. Mm-hmm. Those individuals could be eligible for the palliative and the hospice benefit, mm-hmm. Either or. Mm-hmm. So,
okay. Carlos, give me a sense of how great is the need for hospice care in the St. Louis area?
Well, you know, as you mentioned, it's such over a million people have opted into hospice since 2016. I really feel like it's a population that's been underserved. Hospice is very much underutilized due to a lot of the stigma that's around hospice. When you mention hospice to individuals, a lot of times the first thing that they think is that's it. It's a final destination that's going to happen within the next 24 to 48 hours. At Seasons, we take an approach in the circle of care to honor life and offer hope. And so as a part of our approach, we continue to support not only the patient that actually has decided to sign on and consent to hospice care, but we're there for the family also. And we continue to have conversations, and it's great that you have a platform for us to do so. We appreciate that. I think that it's important that even though there are several choices of hospice companies out there, that it's important that we do have the conversation, and we have the conversation even earlier on. One of the things that I believe is important is to have that conversation with your family. We know we're coming up on the holidays now, and I know that it may not be, one may not see it as the appropriate time, but I think it's an appropriate time to talk about how you would like to see your legacy, how you would like to see things passed on. And so if you're in a position where you are seeking curative care and you're on palliative care right now, having that conversation with your family to talk about next steps and what you would like to, how you would like to be honored. And so I think that it's underutilized. I can't put a number to it, but it's definitely underutilized.
Well, you raised a lot of interesting points in your presentation just now. One of the things that I really want to hone in on when we come back from the break is family and having that conversation, because I think you're absolutely right. So stay with us. We are back in a moment. We'll talk about the family's role in all of this after the break. Welcome back to the Pulse of St. Louis. Tonight we are talking about hospice care and palliative care. And we want to talk a little bit more about the family's responsibility and the family's role in all of this. And Carlos, you touched on something that I think is crucial and critical. The fact that we have to have these conversations, as hard as they are and as painful as they can be, we have to have these conversations. Touch on a little bit more for me about when do you start this process and how do you start this process?
Well, you can start the process as simply as having the conversation with your physician, or it can be had in the physician's office. We talk about advanced care planning and understanding me as a healthy 40-year-old. I can have listed with my physician an advanced care plan that talks about if I'm rendered incapable to make decisions for myself, these are things that I would like to see. This is how I would like for my care to have. So at any point, I think it's important to talk about advanced care planning, which would make your family, it's a gift for your family, if you have those conversations early on, which makes it a little bit easier, because if they understand what your wishes are, although it may be a tough decision to make that step, you understand what your loved one would desired, and so you can just follow in those footsteps. I think Brandy could speak a little bit more to when the appropriate time, and even Jennifer, about the clinical piece.
Right. I'd say one of the things that I think where the stigma comes from with hospice is, you know, and it comes from educating our physicians too, but they do say, there's nothing else we can do, let's do hospice. When really the message should be, you know what, we cannot treat your disease anymore, but there is something more we can do. We can provide hospice for you, because we are going to make sure that they have the best quality of life with what they have left and be able to support them and their families. And, you know, we had a patient just the other day that told the nurse when she visited, you know, I feel like royalty whenever you visit. So, you know, it's those kinds of things that you know, just in the message and how you deliver it is huge.
Go ahead, Brandy.
The conversation about advanced care planning, it sounds so formal, but really, like Carlos mentioned, it's telling your loved ones what, if something were to happen to me, God forbid, this is how I foresee you treating me whenever I am incapacitated and can't treat for myself or advocate for myself. And a lot of times we see in, you know, the world that we work in, unfortunately, most of the time, those conversations and the situations that we are working with the families are just so intense. The decisions have not been made, they're not clear, and you know, we have to help people understand that it's okay to have those conversations, to be proactive.
Right.
And the clinical piece is just one piece of it. You know, the things that we try to encourage families to, you know, talk about, just like Deborah was mentioning earlier, how do you want to be remembered? You know, how do you want to be treated whenever you have made the decision to enjoy a quality of life?
Right. More than
being in the hospital or going to all of these appointments and taking all these medications that counteract with each other. So, I mean, it's really a beautiful thing if you talk about it. And I think somebody just has to start it.
Right.
I think one of the things that we have on our consent process is, instead of talking about medical things, we actually ask, what are three things non-medical that we should know about you? That's huge in making sure that we can all take care of them the best way that they and their family want to be taken care of.
Right. And so what do they typically say when they say the three things that are... I'm just curious.
I want to smoke.
I'm not an early bird.
Right.
Or I love to cook. Or I used to like to knit, crochet, and things of that nature. That's one of the things that they share.
Cardinals fans. Or I just love music, and that's where we can intertwine music therapy. To get them to enjoy, because hospice has this such a negative connotation, but when Deb was talking about music therapy earlier, we talk about how it soothes, but it's the enjoyment that they get also. It allows them to go back to a time, maybe a favorite genre of music that they really loved when they were younger, and it allows them to experience that again. Right. And that's what hospice is about. It's about enjoying a quality of life.
There was a family that around the holidays, and we're coming up on the holidays now.
Right.
So it's a great time. Around the holidays, they had an advance directive party.
Wow.
You know, and so all the family is there, and so you're conversating and you're letting one another know what your wishes are. So that way, if something happens where you can't breathe anymore, you know, you've already let the family know, I don't want a breathing tube. You know, I've lived a good life. You know, let me go. Don't try to, you know, revive me and things of that nature. And so I think that works really well just around the holidays.
Right.
Just, you know, it's a conversation.
Yes, yes. And I can attest, my mom died last year, and we were so amazed, my siblings and I, that she had written everything out. She set us all down before, she, you know, she got to a point where she was incapacitated and said, this is what I want. This is how I want it done. I don't want you guys to be burdened. I don't want you to worry about me. This is what we want. I mean, this is what I want, and we want it methodically done. And I have to tell you, it was the hardest conversation to have, especially when you talk, your mom is telling you, I know I'm dying.
Right.
I know I'm not going to be here, but this is how I want to live the rest of my life. And so as you were talking about, Brandy and Carlos, about this being a gift, it really was a gift because it made it so much easier for us, even though it was tough, it made it easier for us.
Right.
And even when we got to the point where we had to make some tough choices, like, nope. Mom said, here's the page right here, read it.
So then it's not like you're making the choice.
Right.
She made the choice, and you're honoring her wish, which is what, you know, we strive for. Honoring life and, you know.
It's the gift of decreasing the stress of the moment.
And another thing I can tell you that we really appreciated was the team that came to care for her was the exact same team members every week. And that was great because she was very particular about who was coming into her home. She didn't want strangers, and they came over and introduced themselves and explained to her exactly what their respective responsibilities were. And then they would talk to her for a while, and then it was like just a well-oiled machine.
And I think one of the things that we've been able to do in the St. Louis area with our team is we have looked at a different model versus just having on, you know, different people on call every night. We have an on-call team. So if you have to call somebody out, you're usually, there's three different nurses or that you're gonna get, and you've usually met all of them. So that is something that we've, and so we, you know, have full-time staff 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, which has been really great as far as the support of our patients, because, you know, sometimes we have patients that call every night. That's okay, that's what we're here for. They get to know their on-call staff too.
Right.
So, you know, that's another thing, you know, to put somebody at ease, know they have somebody to call.
Form relationships like that.
And how important is that, Deborah, to have those relationships?
It's very important. And we take the relationship on, not just with the patient, but the family member as well. And so we provide support for the patient and with, and sometimes you may have a patient that doesn't necessarily want a particular discipline, but the family member does. And so we still come out and provide support for them. And even after the patient has died, we still provide support for the family, ongoing support for whatever it is that they need.
A lot of it, I think, deals with the grieving process, you know, after that. We'll talk about that after the break. Stay with us back in a moment. Welcome back to the Pulse of St. Louis. Deborah, you touched on something before we went to break about the services for the families and how there are services even after their loved one has moved on, transitioned in life. So tell me a little bit about that.
So once our families have died, we continue to follow their family members. And it could be one particular family member or multiple family members. And we follow them with ongoing bereavement support because oftentimes they're experiencing grief. So we offer grief support groups. We have one-on-one support groups, and we even have a traveling support group.
Wow, because one of my favorites.
Most of our groups are held at our office. So for patients, family members that aren't able to make it there, we found it much easier for us to just go to their home. We recently had a support group in one of our patients' homes, and the whole family came and gathered. You know,
oh, I bet that was beautiful.
It was really, really nice. And they were able to share their experiences and just talk about what their grief process has been. And we know that everybody copes differently.
Yes.
And it looks different with different people. So it's been really great.
Very nice. Jennifer, I want to touch a little bit about some of the different programs that are geared towards the patients. One in particular is the ART program. Tell me a little bit about that.
So the ART program is something our volunteer coordinator did. She actually reached out to a local daycare and just ask if they had art that they could donate to the patients. Just a one-time thing. And it turned into this project where they're doing it for us every week. We have mounds sitting in the office of, you know, little cards and then artwork. And even 6-month-old babies will, you know, do handprints and then they write their name on there. And then we take it to the families and the patients. And it really does brighten their day to see that. Something else our volunteer coordinator does is we have flowers that are donated. Trader Joe's, that donates flowers. And then we have a volunteer that makes up flower arrangements that we take out to our patients every Monday, just to, you know, their birthday, they get a flower arrangement, those kinds of things. Our legacy projects, our memory bearers, we're able to make memory bearers. Just a lot of things that our volunteer department is able to do. We have volunteers that do what's called circle of care calls. So our volunteers call on Wednesdays and Thursdays to check in with the patients. Is there anything you need before the weekend? So we can make sure we're getting them tucked in well for the weekend. They feel like they're supported. So, you know, we don't want them to feel stress of not having, you know, maybe they need some soap or something like that. Right. We want them to let us know that they need something.
Tell me more about the memory bear. I think that's awesome.
Okay, so this memory bear was actually our executive director, Don Mullins. Her father-in-law was on our program. And this is a memory bear. He was a veteran and he loved to ride motorcycles. So they took his t-shirts and they actually made two memory bears, one for his wife and then one for Don's husband. And this is, you know, this is what it turned into. And this is, you know, just in memory of him, you know, being a veteran, being a motorcycle rider, that they were just able to do that. And it's just something, you know, something to have that, you know, it's a cold day and you're feeling bad, you have this bear to hold on to. So, you know, they're so talented. They volunteer. They make these bears, you know, the volunteers do, and they are so talented.
Yeah. Carlos, tell me a little bit more about the importance of the legacy and how important it is so family can know what their loved one's legacy really is.
You know what?
What it means.
So it's a conversation that we have during our time with the patient to find out what they want to leave behind. And so it could be a memory bear, but sometimes it's a book that you want to read to a grandchild that you'll never get to see. We do pre-recorded books so that they can hear the voice of that grandparent. It could be a legacy of accomplishing something that you did in the past, where we've had patients that have participated in pageants. One last pageant, one more time. We've arranged where a loved one was able to be at a wedding via satellite and different things like that. So your legacy could be participating in that wedding. Speaking of weddings, we actually had an opportunity where a lady had the opportunity to sit with her daughter and pick out the wedding dress, just her and her daughter alone in the wedding dress shop to pick it out to make sure that that's the dress that she got to see her daughter wear the dress mm-hmm. prior to her transition. So whatever you want your legacy to be, whatever offers you hope and whatever honors you, that's what we're here to do.
That's awesome. Deb, we were talking about the spiritual services when the mm-hmm. chaplain that goes in. Does it matter whether the chaplain is of the same faith as the patient or no?
Oh, no, not at all. So we provide support for all cultural backgrounds. And it does not matter what your particular denomination is. You don't even have to have a denomination. You know, we serve some patients that don't necessarily believe in God, and we still provide support for them and whatever that looks like for them.
Yeah.
So it's just whatever you need. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's a hug. Sometimes it's a conversation, a listening ear. And sometimes it will be scripture reading or prayer, things of that nature. And oftentimes we have patients that, say for instance, if you're Catholic and the chaplain that goes out to visit with you, they're not Catholic, then you would want a priest. So then we partner with your particular parish or your church to make sure that we provide you with what's needed for your spiritual journey.
Awesome. Brandy, how rewarding is this for you to know that you're making such a big difference in the lives of people?
There's really not a word or a way to describe. It's just, I can speak for us and the rest of our team, it's just what we were meant to do. And I think being that vehicle to help people feel okay to have these conversations, and you mentioned earlier with your mom, you know, it was amazing. You felt so supported and mm-hmm. you know, whoever came into support just started and it worked and it was wonderful. Mm-hmm. I have never ran into anyone, and I don't know if you all have a different opinion, but I've never ran into anyone at the grocery store, at school, at any of the patients' homes or any of the buildings that we go to when we say we're here with hospice, that somebody hasn't said, oh my gosh, my loved one, my sister, my brother, my husband was on it and it was amazing, you know, to help people, as Carlos was kind of talking about. There is a stigma behind it, and it doesn't have to mean this bad sentence. It's just rewarding. It's so fulfilling, and we're just really blessed to be able to do what we do every day collaboratively. You know, we're all of different backgrounds and specialties with what we can bring to the table, and it takes all of us. Yeah. There one missing piece in our link, and it won't work.
Right.
So we have to give people that full continuum of care where they are, whether it's at home or whether it's in, you know, an assisted living or a nursing home. It's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to talk about how to make the choice of which facility to choose after the break. Put them on the spot. Back them on. Welcome back to The Pulse. All right, so you caught us in the break. We were laughing about something. Okay, so we do want to talk about, because this is serious, mm-hmm. and when you are in a position where you have to make a decision mm-hmm. on which facility to use, are there guidelines or things you should look for before you decide, Carlos, you think?
Yes, there are. One of the things that you can do as a family, whether it's if you're looking to be close to your loved ones, you can go on a Medicare Compare website, and you can look at the different facilities that are available in the area, and it will rate the different facilities, and you can make a decision as a family to what's important to you, and you can make a choice that way.
That's a good one. That's a good one.
I tell people, don't rely on the chandeliers, the, you know, the waterfalls, the extra features. It really depends on making a commitment to do a tour and to ask questions mm-hmm. about staffing ratios and how long has, you know, the leadership team and the staff been there? What kind of turnover is there? And getting a true feel for it. A lot of times, mm-hmm. and it's hard to guide a family to make a decision because we want to be unbiased whenever they really are looking for the prettiest place. It's all about the care. So yeah, as Carlos mentioned, nursinghomecompare.gov will give you the star ratings from CMS, so Centers for Medicare and Medicaid. But even if a facility doesn't have a five-star rating, which only 10% of the nursing homes in the state of Missouri are awarded that honor, they only have so many slots, the star ratings will give you maybe guides to questions to ask whenever you go about mm-hmm. staffing and about, you know, their last survey. And all of that is public knowledge, and it's found at the front desk of every facility that you go into. But it's all about having just a good gut feeling about it, too.
Yeah, good point. All right, got to take a break. Final thoughts are up next. Word of mouth. Welcome back. Time now for final thoughts. And Carlos, how about if you give us the final thoughts on this subject, please?
So what I'd like to say is hospice and palliative care is extremely underutilized, and it's important to have the conversation. Open yourselves up to allowing your loved one to experience honor and hope, as we would say, through seasons. And I think that you'll understand once you've embraced it that it's something that you can utilize to honor their legacy. And to find out more, they can always go to seasons.org. And we're just one of the choices that they can utilize.
Perfect. You did that so well. Thank you all so much for being here.
Thank you so much for having us.
And thank you for joining us for the Pulse of St. Louis. Remember, if you missed any part of the show, download the Pulse of St. Louis podcast in the iTunes or Google Play stores. And remember, for News 24/7, download the News 11 app. And for news during the week, be sure to watch News 11 at noon, 4, and 7. And I will see you next time.